everybody. Welcome to the HL Women Writers Live on Instagram. We are here for our monthly writer chat. Today we are talking to Melissa Colasanti, who has written a book called Call Me Elizabeth Lark. And it is a thriller, which is exciting because this is our very first thriller that we've featured in our author series. And once Melissa arrives here and we get the live started, we're going to ask her some questions. And then at the end of our live session, we're going to announce the winner of our giveaway. Our giveaway will win a signed copy of Call Me Elizabeth Lark. They will also win a cute little reading tote. It's actually pretty big. And then we will announce the winner of all that. And then also we have a journal and some cute little swag as well. So Melissa is here. I'm going to invite her in. As we're kind of waiting. Hi, there you are.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Good, can you hear me okay?
I can hear you great. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Hi, how are you? Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, that's awesome. I'm good. We're just enjoying some rainy weather here in Indiana and kind of had a rainy, stormy afternoon. We're just kind of, you know, just chilling, trying to enjoy the spring storms.
Spring, yeah, mm-hmm. That's how it is, right?
April's yeah, right.
Coming up, right?
Absolutely.
April showers, May flowers and all that. That's cool. Yeah, it was a little rainy here too a couple days ago. It's been going odd here in Idaho, on and off. It's kind of weird.
Yeah.
So weather, it seemed like we're gonna have a super early spring, and then I was like, no, just kidding. A little snow even. So.
Well, we're so glad that you could join us, and we're gonna talk about your book, and we're gonna talk a little about writing. And I'm just gonna start with my first question. So tell us about your writing journey. Where did it start for you? Like, how did you get into writing? Because I know all of our paths are a little bit different.
Yeah. So I think a lot of people will, you know, authors will say, you know, that they've been writing since they were really young, since they could pick up a pen. And I definitely identify with that. I remember, and it's interesting that Beverly Cleary just passed away, because mm-hmm. she was probably my biggest inspiration as a little kid. I mean, I remember being at the library, summer reading and all that. And I just absolutely loved Ramona.
Oh, yeah.
She was so great. And I could identify with her. And so, you know, as a little kid, I wrote, you know, stories, and I started doing some nonfiction, like memoir pieces and things like that, which were originally published right as I decided to go back to school, because I have six kids.
Oh, wow.
And I went back to college. They're between the ages of 5 and 18.
Okay.
So I went back to college. Yeah. When
Busy.
It's wow. You're right. That's what people say. So I went back to college when I was, when I was 40, actually. And I wanted to get a degree in creative writing, and I wanted to write novels. And I had already written like one novel, and it really wasn't very good. So I was like, I need to learn how to structure this kind of stuff, you know? So I actually, yeah, it was a really kind of long journey, but also short once I got going, I guess. Maybe it was my age that made it a little bit, I don't know, just like more like, I'm going to persevere at this now because, mm-hmm. you know, I'm not 20 anymore.
I think it's great, though, that you didn't get into writing professionally in this way until, you know, you had had children and you were already established in your life, because I think so many times, especially women, hear that there's an expiration date, you know, like
be it
physically in the dating world or in the marriage world or in the world of having kids or in the career aspect, especially, like, we feel so much pressure all the time to produce and achieve before we turn 30 or 40 or 50, you know? So I think it's really cool that, you didn't adhere to that and that you were just like, you know what, I'm going to go for my dream anyway. Like, I'm just going to go after it no matter what.
Totally. And, you know, having little kids, it's really hard to, and I still did. I mean, my son was like, I think he was like 2 or less when I went back to school. So it still was difficult. It still is, you know, like right now, my husband took them to go get dinner because they're just, they would be too loud for, I mean, every, you know, event or every time I'm trying to write. I mean, it can be really difficult if you, I'm sure everybody, a lot of, you know, women understand or and men, because like my husband is the best. I mean, he really is. And I don't mean that like in the he lets me or anything like that, because it's my career and he has his career and we work together, but we're just 100, I mean, we're just 50-50 on everything. And he's amazing in that way, because a lot of people, it's like I'm hearing how, you know, the women ne necessarily end up doing everything, and I'm just so glad that that's not our case here at all. It's just completely different. And yeah, it is interesting what you say though about the whole there being an expiration date for things, because even like in the writing world, like, you know, for people under, you know, so many people under a certain age or under 30, and I don't know, I think I was able to do a little bit more with my characters and such when I got older and understood that more. I mean, I still, you know, have and had and I'm always learning, but I do think that that portion is a little bit like you understand humans a bit more and what it's like to be going through. And you have stuff to write about, you know, that you've, you know, been through. So, yeah,
Yeah,
very fun.
they say write what you know, and after you've had more life experience, especially in I think the thriller genre is kind of a complex genre for me to understand, because I mostly write YA and a lot of what I've written is contemporary. So like these are things that, and I teach high school students, so that makes sense, right? Like that goes with my world. But the thriller genre, like you have to get things so right. You have to have the beats a certain way, the characters have to be a certain way. But you also can't redo things that have already been done, you know, because a lot of people will try to predict, oh, well, this, I've seen this before a million times, so you have to put a new twist on it. So I guess that could lead me to another question, that this genre seems like it's challenging. So how do you come up with the twists and turns and things that keep it new and exciting? And what's the hardest thing about writing a thriller for you?
I think the hardest thing is that I did start originally in the literary fiction world, and I mean, my book kind of leans a little bit that way too. It's got like a little of both there. And so learning, though, essential to me was learning how to plot and, like you're saying, get those beats and pacing. Not so much like, you know, because writing the plot isn't just that, it's the pacing and the tension and things like that. And I still would say that my books are a little bit less, how should we say, like hard boiled, you know, high octane. And they're like, I lean towards the domestic suspense because I really enjoy exploring like family secrets and the way this family operates, especially in this book. But you're right in that you want twists and turns, but they also have to make sense, you know, for the book, because thriller writers are so smart. They really are. And they just, well, you know, if you've read so many, then you've seen. And another thing that was really interesting, I was talking to a fellow thriller writer about this, is that there's actually a difference between a twist and a reveal. And a lot of writers and readers both don't understand that, like, we set up the little breadcrumbs for the reveals, because we almost like we're helping, you know, we kind of want you to, you know, join us on that path of figuring it out, you know. And so that's not really intended to be always a complete and total surprise, whereas like a twist completely changes the novel. And not every thriller has twists, but like if you look at Gone Girl, for example, if you've read, yeah, like that part in the middle where, you know, we find her, you know, that just shocked everyone. And yet it was wonderful. Like it wasn't the crazy out of nowhere, but it was just really, really well done as far as twists go.
You're right. And it wasn't the newest thing in the world, but
No.
it was the way that it was, the rest of the story was built around it was fresh. And your
Right.
book reminds me of that, you know, kind of that feeling of it's not the newest thing, and I don't want to give away too much, but the way that it's revealed and the way that it the rest of the story is built around it makes it more interesting because you do very much delve into that, you know, family secrets and things like that, which I think makes it its own special thing.
Oh, thank you. I honestly do believe, though, the thing about any book, any genre, whether that's from literary fiction to the most commercial, is that the most commercial, you know, whatever. Even if you have a very a trope which has a very specific need to have, like, let's say, romance, you always have to have that happily ever after. That's expected. But I think the only thing that you can really have that's going to be completely distinctive and your own is going to be your characters. So honestly, getting that right is going to be half the battle in terms of tension and everything, because it's all about their decisions, their desires, and like their agency and all that. So, you know, I think that you're halfway there if you've got that. And then you're sitting there with this kind of thing with a thriller, and I'm doing it right now with my agent for a new thing, is like sitting there doing that whole complex weaving and figuring out of a plot. And this is the first time that I've done so much plotting. Not that I just sit there and write from the, you know, seat of my pants, as I say, but at the same time, I always have, you know, it's always changing. But now it's like, let's try to figure this out completely before we write it. And I'm really hoping that it's gonna reduce some of the revision time, because this was crazy, this book.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that because you mentioned that you have an agent and you're the first author we've interviewed for our feature that had one. So, tell me a little bit about that. Like, you don't have to. I know that querying and finding an agent is a whole separate thing.
Yeah.
And we plan on providing. We're doing like a panel later on,
Right.
this summer to advertise for that. But tell us a little bit about like how you found your agent and what that was like for you.
Sure. And obviously, and I'm sure you'll be getting into this, querying is so difficult. It's almost like it's like joining a punching, you know, a boxing ring, you know. You have to be extremely thick-skinned, and none of us are as writers, so it's just, but I have actually queried about probably four books since I was 40, and I'm 44 now. So, you know, that's 4 years of that. Well, a little bit less, because I met my agent about a year ago. But this was interesting, this book, though, because I knew that this was like the book. It was just that I had work to do throughout the, you know, queries that I sent out and everything. I had work to do on fixing some of the pacing issues in it. So, like, I would send out a bunch of, you know, and then a bunch of queries, and then I would need to occasionally do some revising. So I did a lot of revising even before. But what was interesting and opposite kind of thing that I ended up doing was I actually met my editor from the publisher first, and that was weird. Well, it's unusual, and I don't really like necessarily recommend it, because I did have about 10 fulls out with agents too. So that was a good thing, because when I got I met her, she loved the book. We talked on the phone, and then and a few weeks later an offer came in. And so I had a bunch of agents who had the full, I had a bunch of agents who I had already queried, and then also in this case, if you end up in this situation, you can still go ahead. This is different than having an agent offer, and that you can go ahead and be like, offer and get an agent if this is your, you know, you definitely do not want to just go ahead, because they're going to help you, and they'll help you in your future. I mean, it's just, anyway, so I got six offers of representation from, and they were all really, really nice. Like, they were all good. No, I did not have one that didn't want to do like a
Excuse me.
career, you know, because I wanted an agent for my career for my next book. But Lauren was just so enthusiastic. I mean, honestly, she's awesome, and she is so supportive. I mean, we just went through this whole I mean, we're working on this next book, and she's literally helping me brainstorm. I mean, she's amazing. Lauren Spieler, my agent. But what was interesting is this. Okay, so I'm going to say one thing about querying is that if you get a call from an unusual number while you are querying agents, answer it, because she actually called me, and it was early in the morning for me because I'm in Idaho and she was East Coast. So I didn't answer the phone because it was like an unusual number. And I'm sitting there on my computer, and the first, because I have a Mac, like the phone call came in and I just ignored it. I was like, oh, I told my husband I was probably like a salesperson or something. And also we were like newly in quarantine too, so it could have been anything. So I was like, yeah, I didn't answer it. And then like 3 minutes or less later, I got an email from Lauren. I just tried to call you, and I'm like, oh my gosh. To my husband, I'm like, I totally did not answer her call. So I'm like immediately like emailing back, oh, call again. I'm getting my kids like, settled to do something with my husband. Call me in 20. And then we talked, and she was just so enthusiastic, and I kind of knew right then. And I was so thankful that I did kind of know right at that moment, because I had already been having discussions with agents who were awesome, and I was like, this is gonna be the hardest decision ever. And it still was, but at the same time, I was so happy that I had that feeling like this is the one. So that
That's
was it all.
awesome.
It all went really well.
Yeah, I will say that I do follow Lauren on Twitter, and I believe I queried her a while ago, and she was very sweet. Even in her rejection, she was so sweet. So it seems like you guys are a good match. And I love that she is I think they call it developmental agent. Like she'll help you revise your piece before she sends it out. Where I know some agents either don't do that or they don't have time to do that. So I love that she's doing that with you.
She's very editorial, and that it's super helpful. And also another thing that I love about her is that even in the like we're coming up with an idea phase, she so just gets excited, and we go back and forth. And I cannot, I mean, I never expected to actually have somebody like in my corner that way. So it's been a great, great experience too. And it teaches you about the publishing world too, because you understand like, oh my gosh, these synopses, they're actually important. And everybody hates them, but it turns out they're important.
Yeah, it's a lot of business education, I'm sure you get when you traditionally publish versus like. I mean, I know self-pub is its own beast, with its own rules, but I feel like the traditional publishing, it's like you have so much that you have to learn as far as like control goes. Was it hard for you to give up some of that control, like control of your cover or like control over revisions that you had to make once you got your editor and things like that?
Well, what's interesting is my editor, she's also awesome. She like I feel like getting an edit letter was probably the most beneficial thing to me as an author so far. I mean, I actually am super grateful. We did, and most people might not be, because we did like a huge rewrite of this book.
Oh,
Like
wow.
a lot of it changed plot-wise. But she is just so knowledgeable on that like pacing stuff on thriller. And a lot of like the second half of the book is because of her, suggestions. But then I did the revision and I had a short time to do it, and I thought, oh my gosh, I'm so scared. But she was just like, I love this. And it was like, phew. So honestly, that was, I think it's probably because I had gotten so many rejections in my life prior to this. And also because I have worked with critique partners and other people too. So I like trust other people. If she'd made, I mean, nobody's, she didn't suggest anything that was like to me, like the core of the story. And that's another thing I love about Jenny Chen, is that she got my book. Like when we talked on the phone and stuff, she actually added things to like the mother-daughter relationships and the relationship aspect of this book that I wanted to stay. And I think that there are other editors who might have wanted to go more, full on plot. And she managed to teach me how to put more like pacing plotty stuff in there while also keeping what my vision of it was. So she was good at that. And then the cover, Like, I love the cover.
Yeah, it's a really cool cover.
They did a great job. And so they showed it to me, and we only asked, Lauren and I asked for like barely any changes. I think Elizabeth's lipstick, my agent's like, it looks like she put her lipstick on in the dark a little bit. Can you fix that? And so she, I mean, that was not a big deal. So I feel like, yes, in traditional publishing, you would have to give over some control because you're not going to be able to like have an editor send you a giant, list of revisions and just be like, no, there's probably a couple things you can push back on, but it's not as much. So maybe that's not for you if you're really stuck on keeping it the exact same. But if you like are more interested in, I don't know. I was interested in making it the best it could be, and I felt like I was okay with putting that in her hands because she had more experience than me in terms of that. But if you want to, there are people though that are like, I'm not good at sales and things like that. And so if you're good at that and you like, there are people that are do so awesome with self-publishing. Like I'm completely in awe of that, and I think it's awesome. I personally didn't have the like sales savvy or any of that, or like even know how I would format things or whatever, for that kind of thing. So that's why I went for traditional, publishing. But it, I do think it's amazing people who can do it. They're just two different subsets of skills, I think, in terms of that,
I'm also not like I could not work in the business world. It makes me really nervous and anxious to think about like marketing and media and things like that. So I totally understand like wanting to go traditional because I know that a lot of the marketing is also up to you and that like you have to share things on your social media and stuff like that. But it's nice to know that, you have people that are making your book sellable, I guess, getting it on the shelves and things like that, which is really nice.
Well, and I feel like going through the editing process with someone, it really scares me the thought of potentially putting out a book that's not 100% edited really well. So that scares me, even though I am an editor, At the same time, I see both ways. I mean, yeah, we still do like a lot of our stuff, but at the same time, also there's expense involved. Like I couldn't afford to self-publish, I don't think. Because, to do it correctly, there's a lot of money involved.
There is a lot of money, and it depends on like if you go with print or just ebook. And yeah, we have quite a few self-pub authors that we talked to, and the cost is definitely a concern, which is I could see why, it would be daunting for some people, but especially if you put so much in and you don't even know how it's going to do,
That's the other thing. It depends on genre too, because certain genres like romance do so well on ebook, and then other ones like this one kind of don't, because it's just really it's even saturated in the market, in the like traditionally published market. So there's, and anything literary is going to be harder too. So I mean, it's just like it depends on the genre. I mean, too, so much. I
Yeah,
see these
absolutely.
romance authors that do amazing, and then they have agents calling them. I mean,
Yeah, we had one author who writes romance, and she started on Wattpad and got over 1 million reads on Wattpad. And I
wow.
was like, wow. It's just, ebook publishing romance. I guess like you said, it depends. But speaking of genre, I want to talk a little bit about this, about the thriller kind of literary fiction genre blend that you have. A lot of it seems to be dominated by men. So, as you continue to put your work out there and other women continue to publish this, what would you love to see change in that way? I mean, I know that maybe you haven't had a chance to attend a lot of like conferences and stuff because of COVID, but I know that some genres that are dominated by male writers, when you go to events like that, you kind of see more of that and you see things that you might want to change. So what are some changes you might want to
You're
see?
correct in that I haven't been to a lot of conferences, and that is like a completely probably different topic. But in terms of the writing, I am really happy. Like I know a bunch in the recent times of really wonderful thriller writers who are women, and they do tend to be like a little bit different, very female driven typically, and Instagram's a great place really to meet those kinds of people. And also I have so many friends who, oh my gosh, they're just awesome. But I think that there is a little bit of the problem that I see personally in the thriller realm is that those of us who write unlikable female characters, and I wouldn't say mine are completely, but they do have secrets. They're not perfect. They have flaws and everything else. And but those who do want to say write a sociopathic woman, you know, run into a lot of people saying, well, this character isn't very likable, but you don't necessarily get that with male characters. They're allowed, they're given a lot more grace. And I really wish that would change. I think just from a feminist perspective, I don't understand it, but I think that it's something almost like ingrained into people's mind that women have to be polite or something, or at least, you know, likable. Because one example that I actually wrote about in Crime Reads, for an article that I wrote on duplicitous female characters in novels, and I plugged a bunch who weren't that nice. And the main thing that I actually was thinking about when writing that was, okay, so if we have a male detective and they're an alcoholic, for an example, and we're always like, oh, he has a stressful job. That's a good flaw, you know, to have for this guy, because poor him, he has this stressful job, you know, dealing with criminals all the time and everything else, right? And he's, you know, sitting there at work drinking, you know, three fingers of whiskey. Yet we have like Girl on a Train, which was Girl on a Train was great, and you know, it did really well. But if you hear any backlash that you do hear on that is always about Rachel wasn't likable, or Rachel, nobody's like, oh, Rachel had a really stressful life before she sat there on the train that day and started getting drunk all the time. I mean, she really did have her reasons, but we don't, I mean, even the people that love that book, and I love that book, don't necessarily, you know, put that. They're just like, oh yeah, that was like a thing about Rachel. That it was just a vehicle so that she could not remember what happened. But I mean, I thought she was a great character despite the fact that, you know. So I think that, you know, that's something that needs to change.
Yeah, I agree. And when you brought up the male characters and the criticism, like, I know that you is written by a woman, but the main character, and it's crazy because as it was made into a TV series, I would see tweets and hear my friends say this all the time, like, I shouldn't be rooting for this guy, but I am. Like, he's totally crazy, but I'm rooting for him. And I can't help but think so many times, like, if it were a woman, would we be feeling the same way? I don't know. And even in, not to spoil it, but like in the second season, when we get a little bit of that, and then in the second book as well, like, people criticize her more than they do him. So, yeah, that definitely is present for sure. And that also brings me to my next question about your characters. I loved what you said about how women are expected to write these perfect little characters, but you try to make your characters realistic and they have flaws. But so how do you write such perfectly flawed and fearless characters?
Oh, that's sweet. I don't know if it, you know, I actually, that's probably the first thing that I try to gather and understand. And another thing I would recommend for anybody who does want to like work on writing super well-rounded characters is Story Genius. I'm not sure if Lisa Crone wrote that, and it's great. It has like ways of exploring character that's different than just like writing a outline of their, you know, desires and everything. I mean, you're like writing scenes that dig into them and their past and their everything like that, and their backstories. Because what's interesting about backstory is our books begin midway, so everything that happened to this character before the beginning of the book really does influence the book. It doesn't need to be, all of it doesn't need to be in the book, otherwise we're going to be overloading it with backstory. But at the same time, just knowing it and dropping it through in breadcrumbs and giving that understanding, I think it's helpful. And it's also helpful, I think, if you want to do something like with multi point of views, such as you want to probably have really distinctive voices. Like, pick, even there's just a tip, even pick different aged, different personalities, different walks of life people, and then it's going to be a lot easier. I mean, if you have like 2 21-year-olds on women on, you know, each, it's going to be harder to probably make them as distinctive, but you know. So I don't know. I feel like I do that a little bit more intuitively than I do, you know, figuring out the plot from A to Z. That takes me more time, I think. Well, actually, figuring out characters who does take me a long time, but it's something that I like doing for a while, even before I start thinking really about what's going to happen. Because if I know, I don't know why, it makes it easier. But everybody has their process, so that's just, you know. Some people like to just sit down, and I've heard of people who do great, great characters who sit down and they plot it out from A to Z, and then they choose the person they want to put in this situation. So that's one way. I mean, it just, I guess it just depends.
Yeah, my process is similar. Like, it the character comes to me first, and then I decide, okay, what is this person's story? You know, like character
Right,
driven
yeah.
plot. And I think that's so important, because so many times you'll read a story and it's like the plot drives the character, and really this character could be anyone. And maybe that's the point of some stories, so that we can easily insert ourselves into the story. But so often that doesn't make for quite as a thrilling read, especially whenever you're in a genre that's kind of complex and relies on complex characters for the plot to evolve, like your genre does, and like your book does. So I love that you start with character and then move from there. That's great.
And if you were saying you write like contemporary YA, so that is one example where you definitely need that. Like, you want to be writing somebody fully fleshed out that these, you know, teens can identify with. And I love that. And I love that you teach high school, because that right there, you know,
Close to
I
my
mean,
source material.
you have source material. Yeah, I have 2 teens right now that are, you know, 2 of my kids are teens. So, you know, one tells me more than the other. But and also I think you got to remember being a teen, because as we deal with actual teens right now, oh gosh, you really
It is
don't know
tough.
everything.
Yeah, it is tough. They have it rough. I do feel for them. So it's okay. I mean, sometimes you look at the issues that they go through and you're like, this is so small. You don't really understand how small this problem is. But to them, it's huge. You know,
Right
it's a
now,
big
it's huge.
life-changing thing. Oh yeah, this whole pandemic has really weighed on a lot of them, and I really do feel for them. Like, in
I
ways
do.
that I always tell my coworkers, I'm like, look, we're having a hard time. Imagine having to deal with this with less life experience and less emotional maturity.
Yeah. It's
It's
honestly, my teens have had a harder time with this than my young kids. Because with young kids, it's like, okay, we'll take you to the park where no one's at. You can wear a mask if anybody comes around, fine. Now, I have older kids who pushed and pushed and pushed because they want to socialize. And at a certain point, I was just like, okay, because, you know, we'll be safe about it. And the 2 of them are old enough to get the vaccine here soon. So there's that. But I've been nervous about them, you know, socializing, but at the same time, they were losing it. Not.
I can see it in the eyes of my students that I teach in person. So, like, we're hybrid right now, but we're about to go back full force after spring break.
Same. That's the same with what they're doing here. They've
And
been
so
hybrid.
I can see that they need it. And I know that I don't know, I have mixed feelings about it, because I mental health versus physical health,
Yeah.
it's a hard call to make at this point. I don't envy the people that have to make those calls.
It is a hard call, and I feel for teachers too. Hopefully you've been able to get vaccinated over there because of being a teacher, that is awesome. But in the beginning, I kept my in the beginning because I had such massive like emotional meltdowns for my high school kids. I let them go to the hybrid schedule once they started. But my younger kids, I had I was homeschooling because I was like, this is going to be terrible. They're worse. Little kids are a lot worse at being able to contain their germs and stuff like that. So I was like, heck no, we're not going to school. But then after about, or like, I don't know, I think it was January when I finally had to send them back because my husband and I were not working. Like we were getting nothing done. And it was like, okay, do we keep our house or do we, And
It's
my
tough call.
youngest, yeah. And my youngest still is here. He's 5. So he's home anyway. But it's actually been kind of helpful, the hybrid schedule, because my teenager is actually helpful with him. Now they're all going back except Mondays. I guess they'll be home. It was a really, really hard call. And in our case, it wasn't just like a little bit of homeschooling. It was through a charter school where I was literally teaching my 7-year-old 7 hours a day, and she could not do any of it herself. None. So I was running from her bedroom into my 9-year-old's bedroom. The 11-year-old had gotten it pretty well all day long. And then sitting down and trying to write a little bit for
That's
things that
rough.
were, and it was due. I had stuff due. Oh, and I was a full-time college student because I just graduated in December.
Oh,
So,
wow. Well, congrats on graduating.
thank you. So it was just like, okay, it was the right thing to do. They're being careful, but at the same time, it was very scary.
I can imagine. I have an 11-year-old, and that was a struggle for us to decide, well, are we going
It's
to send him
hard.
back or not? And he's special needs, so like he really needs his services, and he's same boat, like he can't really sit and do all of his by himself, like he needs guidance, and he struggles especially in math. So I totally get that. And I don't fault, I've been telling people this whole time, like I don't fault parents for whatever decision they make, because we're all just trying to survive.
So hard. I mean, honestly, I just feel like, yes, we all need to be social distancing. And honestly, the school situation wouldn't be as serious if people were in other parts of their life doing a little bit more, I think. Personal opinion in there, but yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, speaking of non-writing things, what non-writing hobbies or interests do you love? I know you have lots of kids and probably keeps you very busy outside of writing time, but what when you're not writing, what would you like to be doing?
Yeah, so I mean, I do love spending time with my kids, but the one thing for me is, and just me, is exercise. And then when my gym closed down immediately,
Oh, yeah.
initially it was really hard, but then my husband and I got spent some time and put together a home gym. I got a spin bike, like invested in that, and
Nice.
I started streaming kickboxing from Krista DiPaolo. I just love her. She's so good. I streamed that into the same room, and my husband got like a weight rack and stuff where he and also my 18-year-old workout. So now that I have my own space, I actually like it a little bit better than the gym because I can go anytime. Whereas like the gym, I mean, I went 5 days a week for the past over a decade, but at the same time, it's like I would miss classes. I would just be able to just go running. I mean, it was always so difficult to get everybody ready and in the car and doing it. But like this, I can just go in there at any time. If I can't work out in the morning, I'll just go in the afternoon. So that's fun.
That's
And
awesome.
also, yeah, so that's probably like my biggest thing. And reading. I love reading. I try to read as much as I can, and literature is a big part of my life, of course.
And as a writer, you have to read. It is
Oh,
writing. Writing is reading, and reading is writing. So
absolutely.
absolutely. That's awesome that you have I love that you have a home gym. I have excuse me, I have a treadmill, so
Well,
that's all
that's
that we
good.
really have. But we live in the city, so we can walk lots of places, and things like that. We
Yeah.
live like around the corner from a park, which is nice.
That
So
is nice. We have a lot of that here too, but what happened was in the summer and the spring, last summer and spring, we were running. My husband and I were jogging outdoors. I mean, like the masks were actually helpful because we have allergies, and that was actually making that worse when I was used to running around the track at the gym. And I mean, I missed my classes, but I was okay with that. And then the weather came in, and it was like, okay, what do we do now? And so my decision was between the treadmill and the bike. I wasn't sure where to go, and then I just ended up going with the bike side. Like spinning, and also I was like, well, space, but we'll just do this. And then I just do that, and I do kickboxing, and I like the fact that it has, I don't know if your treadmill does this, but it's so cool how they have these like workouts where you're literally riding with the instructor down different like scenic routes and stuff.
Yes,
It's
that's cool.
fun. Yeah,
That
it's
is really
fun.
cool. Well, before we go, let's talk about what's next for you. What other projects? I know you mentioned that you're working on another book. What other projects should we be looking out for yet for from
So,
you?
one, we have a completed book. It doesn't quite have a home yet, but hopefully it will. And that one is it's a dual timeline mystery. I would call it more of a mystery than a thriller because it has a detective in the present, and she's in a small town. And find out for my books, I always write small towns because I love like the atmosphere and stuff. It's like a little island town off the Washington coast. So she is dealing with a woman in town who is a hoarder, and unfortunately, they have to tear her house down, which she feels terrible about. But then they find a body.
Oh, wow, that's cool.
And then she's going to find out who the body is. And the body is somebody that she knows from the past,
Ooh.
which will be the other timeline. And that timeline is from the person who died, and that person like leading up to her death.
Oh, wow, that
So
sounds
that,
so cool.
and then we're working on like a super secret thing that I'm writing like the beginning of right now. That
Oh,
one,
awesome.
luckily, I'm so happy is actually done and almost revised. I think maybe one or two more little passes before we send it off. But yeah.
Very cool. Well, that's awesome. Before we go, too, we have one more thing that we need to do. We need to announce our winner of our giveaway. So
Ah,
our giveaway gets your book, some
the
cool swag that you included. Thank you so much for that. And it
And
also
like this
includes,
is,
yes, there it is, the
it's go
beautiful
backwards,
cover.
but
Yeah, and
yeah.
we also got a tote from Viewpoint Books, which is a local bookstore that we love. And we see that they joined High Viewpoint. And then we
Oh,
also got a
awesome.
cute little journal in there too. So if you
Oh.
want, you can go ahead and announce who that person is.
Okay, drum roll. No. The Pink Narnian has won the book and the tote and
Yay!
the journal. Yay!
Congrats.
Congratulations.
We will DM that person and tag that person so they know. And we
So
actually got
cool.
one more. We have one more thing before you go. We have a fan question that just got submitted. Who is the most powerful president you could defeat in hand-to-hand combat? We always end these with like a silly question. So
Okay,
who do you think?
powerful president that I could defeat. Oh, oh my gosh, this is tough. That I really could, or I mean, God, I would love to beat that Trump guy down. And I kind of feel like he's a little off right now, so maybe, and I am doing kickboxing.
That's what I was gonna say. You're a kickboxer. You could probably defeat quite a few of them in hand-to-hand combat. That's
Yeah, who
awesome.
knows? I mean, at their age at this point, but not necessarily fair, but I don't want to think about some frail ex-president. But
Well,
that one I would love to take down. Yeah.
yeah, I agree. I love that. That was awesome. Thank you so much for joining us. We
Thank you
appreciate it. It
so
was so
much for
fun.
having me. Thank you for having me. This has been a great week, and I really appreciate it.
Yeah, we've loved having you, and we are so excited, and we hope that everybody checks out your book, Call Me Elizabeth Clark. It's out now. You can get it at any major retailer, or we prefer your local independent bookstore. And thank you so much, Melissa. Have
yeah,
a good
and
night.
But oh, I oh, wanted to say one quick. If anybody here does order the book from Indie or wherever bookstore or any bookstore, if you want a signed bookplate, just go to my website and it's on my profile, and I'll send you that.
Yes, that's so nice. Like thank that. You. That's awesome.
All right, so have a great evening.
Thank you too. Bye, everybody.
Bye, guys.